guys for sending us. It really impacted my life and the lives of these students right here. I think Ryan's going to lead us in prayer, and then we're going to share some songs that we learned at camp and just have some time of worship.
Last night, I'm pretty sure God told me to write a prayer to pray for us this morning, so I'm going to do just that. Dear Lord Jesus, we come to you this morning and we just lift up these kids, Lord, and I pray that all throughout their life they are on fire for you and that they hunger for your word and have a light that never goes out. And I pray that this morning that the songs that we sing will touch the brethren in the crowd and that they are able to feel your presence in the sanctuary this morning. We pray all of this in your name. Amen.
Stay.
that song became an anthem at camp, especially in the times that we're in, when sometimes all we see around us is the battle and the struggle, and it seems like one thing after another. But what a reminder that God is in control of all things, and he goes before us and behind us, and he's leading every step of the way. So when we fight as believers, we fight on our knees, trusting him that he has all things in the palm of his hands. And so as we continue to worship this morning, Graves into Gardens is the next song. We're a little bit shy up here, but it's because we're in a different setting and we don't usually stand up here and sing for you guys. But what an anthem this is, that we can look to the world to find fulfillment, but we'll never find it. We can find our life in material things. We can try, but we'll never find it. Jesus is the only true satisfaction. He is our fulfillment. He is all that we need. He turns beauty to ashes, ashes to beauty, graves into gardens. So as we sing this song and we proclaim it this morning, if you know it, worship with us and sing it out from the top of your lungs.
Nothing better than you, oh, there's nothing.
This was probably my favorite song to watch these students that are standing before you worship to at camp. Because this song is a prayer. Often we carry burdens from the world. We carry shame from the past. Often we carry the weight from the day and the week. But when do we make room for Jesus in our lives? And so this song is a proclamation that I will lay down all my burdens to you, Lord. I will surrender everything that I have and everything that I am. And I will make room for you. I will make you Lord of my life and allow you to lead. So we pray this morning that this blesses you. This is our last song for you guys. Have you enjoyed the youth this morning? You guys hear me? You guys are doing a great job. And this is the last song that we exited camp with. It was our pump-up song, and it was something that we took into the world when we left, that there's a world outside our window. There's people who need Jesus, and so we're going to bring that to them. So we hope this blesses you this morning. Thank you. Here's some.
Yeah.
What is she? Let me try her. Oh, Mandy. So we're going to take just a few minutes, and there was some incredible church time this year. After every worship service, we met outside under this pavilion, and each of us shared what God did in our lives. Some gave their life to Christ. Some said they've been walking down a path they knew that they shouldn't be on, and they wanted to come back into the path of the Father. There were some who surrendered to the ministry. God did an incredible work this year. So we're going to start with Miss Molly, and she's going to share what God did in her heart at camp.
Hello. Okay, so this was my third year going to camp, and it's just incredible. Words can't explain how much camp has an impact on me. And I just love seeing it impact the people around us, like the church group. I love seeing them worship, and it's just great. I rededicated my life to Christ because I felt like I've been walking down the wrong path, and so I decided I need to get back on track. And yes, I always look forward to camp. It's always my favorite time of the year, and the day I get home, I'm ready to go back already. And I just love camp so much, and I can't wait to go next year.
Hey, y'all. So my name is Jaden, and this is my third year going to church camp at Latham Springs, Wild Week. I feel like this year wasn't like any other year we went. This year, there was way more of an impact than I've ever felt. I actually really felt the presence of the Lord this time at church camp, just like no other. I rededicated my life to Christ because I felt like I was, as Molly and many other people, I was kind of going down the wrong path, you know, before church camp, and it just, I felt like that. And I also surrendered my life to the ministry. So that was a big step. I know that I forever want to live my life through Christ, and just whatever I do, I know I want to teach people about the Lord. My favorite part about church camp, I guess I'll tell y'all that, you know, is definitely meeting new people, but not only that, I love seeing the rest of my youth group, especially the younger ones, grow through the Lord. It's such a beautiful sight, like literally just as Molly said, words cannot describe it. It's the best feeling ever, knowing that your church family is just growing just as you once did and are still growing, because I feel like everyone, no matter the age, you can still grow through the Lord. I've seen people way older, way younger, any age, get baptized and surrender their life to the Lord. So, yeah, thank y'all.
Hey, my name is Jazzy, and church camp was definitely life-changing. It was very powerful. And, like, words cannot describe. The worship was great. It was amazing. It definitely changed my life in many ways. My favorite part about church camp was hanging out with my friends and seeing everyone get closer to God. Like, it was amazing. And, yeah.
This is my third year going to Wild Week, and this year, I really felt the Lord's presence, and it actually hit me harder than any other year. And I just love seeing the youth group and all worshiping, and especially the younger ones growing through the week. And
stop smiling. My name's JC. This is my first year going to camp. I really I really liked the worship. I just felt a big impact. I felt God telling me to just share his word. That's like one thing I've really struggled with. I just felt him telling me that, to do that. And I also like seeing everybody go closer to God. After our worship, we just got in groups, and that was just really a really powerful message everybody gave. Like, we all shared just things we struggled with, and we all came together as a group. So, yeah.
This is my first year going to camp, and the first night I committed my life to God, and I really loved worship this year.
Hi, I'm Hazley. This year at camp, I gave my life to Christ, and later that week, I decided I wanted to teach the Lord about the Lord. So, and my favorite part of camp was just seeing my friends grow in the Lord.
This was my first week ever going to, this was my first year ever going to Wild Week. And I just want to say it was a life-changing experience. And I didn't want to come back home. I wanted to stay there. I wanted to live there. It was so great there. Yeah, maybe I'll be hired sometime. I don't know. But Monday night, like all of the nights of worship were really great. The worship was really nice. But Monday night was really, really good. Like you could totally feel that Jesus Christ was in the room. You could just totally feel it. It was great. And it's just so cool seeing everybody just worship God and have a fun time doing it. And I just think that's a great thing, and I'm definitely going back next year.
This is my fourth year going to Wild Week, and this year at camp was one of my favorite years. All the people in our cabin and the worship and everything. In our cabin, though, him right there. Every night he would be snoring or something, and all the other cabins, boys in our cabin, we bonded over him snoring. We'd be like, shh. Ryan's trying to sleep, as loud as we could, and everyone was just having fun, and that camp was just really good this year.
Can y'all hear me through this?
My name's Mandy, and this is my first year for church camp, and it was so awesome. It truly was, and I'll try to talk without crying, but it's kind of hard. Because I spent probably the whole week crying. It was just such a blessing to be with all these children and to see them grow and worship and just like be able to just we unplug them from the world, basically, is what we did. We took them and we said, no phones, no nothing. You call mama if you need to. Call mom and dad if you need to. But we took them out and we put them in this environment where all they had to do was think and focus and get their heart set on God. And it was nice, wasn't it? It was nice. And it allowed them to reconnect with God and allowed them to connect with each other and the bonds that they made and just seeing my son grow was amazing. We had these breakout sessions that we got to choose and the kids got to go and learn more about Jesus and kind of learn some things that helps them grow in their faith. And Ryan, he was like, I know exactly where I'm going. I'm going to Chris Lovell because I want to learn how to tell my story so that I can help someone find God and learn how he can help them. And I want to tell people that, and I want to know how to do that better. And I thought that was so amazing to have a
see my child just grow like that, you know? You see your children certain ways, but when you see them grow in the Spirit and the Lord, oh, my word, praise God, okay? So we have to nurture these children, okay? We have to be there for them. They are going to get lost along the way. It happens. It happens to everybody. But us as Christian and as adults, we have to be with these children. We be with these youth, and we have to encourage them to stay on that path and to let them know you're not going to be perfect. Nothing's going to be perfect, okay? But it's going to be okay, because who do you have? You have Jesus Christ in your corner, right? And he will always be there no matter what. And I'm just telling you, it was just a beautiful experience. We went from Sunday night to Wednesday night, singing praises to the Lord. I mean, what you saw on that video, I tried to capture what I felt in my heart every night. And I know I used duplicate pictures a lot. You would see Peyton with his hands up and the girls clapping and stuff. But those were moments I looked to my left or right, and I would see these children just, it didn't matter what anybody else was thinking. They were just like, thank you, Jesus, and singing their hearts out. And I loved every bit of that. And I just want to try to capture that for you so you would see it's hard. Like they say, it's hard to put into words the joy and the just the feeling that you have. It just makes you whole. And you could just really feel the Spirit of Jesus there. And I am so thankful that we have so many lovely people that gave these children a chance to go, and I'm so excited for next year. Are you guys ready for next year? I'm kind of like Ryan. I really didn't want to come back. It was fantastic, and there was one really day that I want to tell about Peyton and Jazzy. Was it you and Jazzy? We played, capture the flag, but was capture the chicken, and we had these rec games. And, you know, people, I just feel like people dominated us sometimes because we were so small. But that game was fantastic. We were on this team with these 18-year-old kids, and they were just huge and loud and just kind of towered over our children. And we were playing capture the chicken. And capture, it's kind of like capture the flag. You got to scoot across the enemy lines to grab the flag and bring it back to your side. And those older kids, they tried and tried, and they kept failing. And over in the corner of my eye, I could see Jazzy. She's had a plan. She was sneaking around, and everybody was, they were caught up in some other things going on, capturing other people. And she waited right to the right time, and she jotted across that enemy lines, grabbed that chicken, and all of a sudden, these people are chasing her. And then Peyton's like, Jazzy! And she throws this NFL pass. It was the prettiest chicken I ever saw. It was flying across the sky. And here's Peyton, like he was a wide receiver. Ooh, he caught that chicken and ran to victory. And we were like, yeah, in your faces, 18-year-old people. We got this. So we had a victory too, right? The Chicken Express. There we go, Chicken Express. So we had a great time. And I love you guys. I'm so proud of you. And I hope that you continue this journey with Jesus. Just like Lacey and I said when we were there, we are committed to you. And we will be here for you. Anything that you need. Okay? Thank you.
Wow, Mandy. I can't follow that. You spoke my heart. And one other leader that's not here that was at camp there in Colorado right now, Ed Teal, he went with us. And Ed shared several times in our group times after the worship, and he did an incredible job. He loves these kids, and he really loves you guys, and you're the only reason that he went. It's hot, it's a long week, you're exhausted, but it's all worth it because God moves in powerful ways. And then Bucky Terry, who's not here this morning, he's feeling pretty down. He's not feeling well. He called me to let me know this morning he couldn't make it, but he wanted to be here. He was our driver, and golly, he got us there safely and was there early to pick us up and in good spirits the whole time. But I'm going to ask you guys to be seated for just a minute.
In our youth time, we have been talking, we've been going through the book of Acts, and it kind of lined up with camp this week. And so I'm just going to take a few minutes. If you have your Bibles, if you'll turn to the book of Acts with me, we're going to be in chapter 7. I'll give you just a minute. One thing that I learned, I taught a breakout while we were at camp this year. It's the first time that I'd ever done that. And I'd gone down to the prayer garden so that I could have some quiet time alone with the Lord to kind of prep my message. And there was a group of teens down there. It wasn't our group. It was a different group from another church. And they were down there to have Bible study that morning before worship time. And they walked up as I was sitting there on the bench flipping through my Bible. And they said, "Do you mind if we sit here?" I said, "Of course not. Take a seat." So one couple lined this bench. A couple hopped up on this stone that was in the prayer garden. It was praying hands. A couple sat on the ground before me. And she said, "Okay, open your Bibles to Matthew." They were about to have Bible study. Bless my heart. And I said, "Do you guys mind if I ask you a few questions?" He said, "Not at all." So I said, "When you go back home, what is the greatest temptation that you're going to face? The greatest struggle that you have from staying in the Word of God every single day?" And it would blow your mind, some of the comments that I heard. There was a high school football player there. He looked like he was about a senior. I said, "What's your greatest struggle?" And he said, "If I'm being honest, it's drinking. I struggle with alcohol. I go to the parties and I drink and my witness is gone, because I'm living exactly as the world does. But through this week, I've learned that I've got to surrender that to the Lord, and I've got to be a better example for those around me so that I can share the gospel of Jesus Christ." Then I looked at the girl next to him, and I said, "What's your greatest struggle?" And she said, "My greatest struggle is sleeping all day. I'd rather go home and sleep all day and hide in my room. And I don't ever pick up my Bible because I'd rather sleep. But I'm not going to do that anymore. That's why I'm here this morning in my Bible." Now look at the next guy. I said, "What's your greatest struggle?" And he said, "Standing up in front of my friends. I'm afraid to talk about Jesus because I'm afraid of what they'll think of me. I'm afraid I'm going to lose all of my friends if I start talking about him. But I've made the commitment this week that I'm going to go back home and I'm going to tell them all about Jesus." I was so moved by these stories. And then this one blew my mind. I looked at the last guy sitting there. I said, "What's your greatest struggle?" And he said, "I'm never satisfied with what I have." What wisdom to notice this. He said, "Anything that comes out, I have to have it. The latest cell phone, the new pair of shoes. I have to have the best and the best and the best, and my parents give it to me." He said, "But I've learned this week that true satisfaction is only found in my God. And so I'm not going to go home to that. I'm not going to go home asking for more things and more things." I want to look at a story this morning very quickly. And you've probably read it. It's the story of Stephen. He was the first Christian martyr in the Bible. This is after Jesus had been crucified and the church had begun, and these people were sharing the gospel and they had appointed people, and Stephen was one of that to take care of the church. And Stephen was very bold in his faith. Stephen was willing to stand up at all cost. And this is an example that I think that we all should hear this morning. We should be living out our faith in this way. Look at verse 54. When they heard these things, talking about the religious leaders of that day, Stephen had just preached an entire message. He just stood up to the religious leaders of that day boldly. And the Bible says in verse 54, when they heard these things, they were cut to the heart and they gnashed at him with their teeth. But he, being full of the Holy Spirit, gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God and said, "Look, I see the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." Then they cried out with a loud voice, stopped their ears, and ran at him with one accord. They were angry. And they cast him out of the city and stoned him.
And the witnesses laid down their clothes at the feet of a young man named Saul. You guys recognize that name? And they stoned Stephen as he was calling on God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then he knelt down and cried out with a loud voice, Lord, do not charge them with this sin. And when he had said that, he fell asleep. What an incredible privilege Stephen was allotted in that moment to look up into the heavens as he was being stoned to death and see the glory of God and Jesus Christ seated at the right hand of the Father. And I believe that God allowed him to see that because of Stephen's faith and steadfastness in the Bible, in the scriptures, in his faith. Steadfast. I've been focused on that word since camp. Steadfast means firmly fixed. It means immovable. It means not subject to change. It means firm in our belief. It means determination in our faith. The Bible says, therefore, my beloved brethren, remain steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. God's calling us to step out and stand and be immovable in our faith. And there's only one way that we can do that. A lot of us, if we're being honest with ourselves, we'd have to go home and dig for our Bibles. We'd have to search through some drawers. We'd have to dust it off when we found it because it's been a while since we've picked it up. But the way that you grow in your relationship with Christ is by digging deep in his word and learning what he has to say. I tell my youth all the time, if I did not go home and spend time with my husband, there would be a big problem in my marriage. But I don't want there to be a problem, so I go home and I spend time with my husband. We have this incredible relationship with the God of all creation. And if we're being honest with ourselves this morning, how often do we spend time with him? How often do we pick up this incredible love letter that he's left for us with wisdom and knowledge of how to live out our lives in faith, of how to prepare ourselves for what is to come in the future? Because I believe with all my heart that we're in the end times and we have to suit up. We have to put on the full armor of God and be ready to stand against the schemes of the devil. And we cannot do that if we are not in his word, if we are not spending time with him every single day, if we're not suiting up when we wake up and studying the scriptures, if we're not spending time in prayer and worship. We cannot stand against the schemes of the devil. And we will not bring people to Jesus. So that's the message we got at camp. As the last night that Chris Lovell, he's the head basketball coach at East Texas Baptist University. And his message was the importance of the Word of God. And he was saying, students, and this is so true, students, you face more in this life than I've ever faced in my life. You walk into schools filled with homosexuality, filled with, you're tempted with drugs and alcohol every single day. Some of the stories that I hear from you guys and what you walk into blows my mind. And that's why, church family, we have to stand firm with them. We have to set the example. We have to suit up. And we have to be there. As Mandy said, we are committed to you. Through every step of your life, we are committed to you. We are your church family, and we're here to stand firm with you every step of the way. Because it's a difficult world that we live in, and it's only going to get worse, I believe that. The Bible says in Psalm 119, your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light in my path. And Romans 15:4, the Bible says, for whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, that through endurance and through the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. The Bible says in Psalm 119:11, I have stored up your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. And then my final scripture for today in Hebrews 4:12. For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart.
open this love letter, church family. Open this manual that he's left us, but he didn't have to leave it, but he left it. Open it up and find out what God has to say about you. Find out what he has to say about what we're in right now, because I promise you will find it. He's preparing his people, I believe, in the time that we're in for what is to come. And if we're not careful, we'll miss it. We'll miss it all. So suit up. Read Ephesians chapter 6. That was our homework when we left camp. And put on the full armor of God. And be prepared to stand in a world that is so dark. I'm going to ask Brother Byron to come up. And I think Mike and Mandy are going to play a song. We'll just have a little bit more time of worship this morning.
Y'all, this is a great day for our church and for me especially. I've got to watch these. They're not kids anymore. They're teenagers now. They're growing up. And I've got to watch them grow, and not only grow in height, as they are all doing, but in the love of God. These kids, and I call them kids because I'm so old. Kids anymore, but it's amazing to watch how they do love the Lord, and how when they're asked to do something here, they jump in and do it. Their Wednesday night class, I hear so much about it. I don't always get to make it, but I'm just so proud of all of you, because y'all are the leaders. Y'all are the ones that are going to lead not only this church, but other churches. You're going to be the ones that influence your friends at school. I can't tell you what y'all mean to me as a group of hope. And on a lighter note, I really enjoyed all of you telling about camp and what you thought, and I really enjoyed when the sisters were picking at each other. There's two sets of sisters up here, and they were kind of jabbing the other one when they got the microphone, so that was fun to watch. Love you guys. You mean the world to me. When we dismiss, I'd like for y'all to go out into the lobby with Lacey, Mandy, you also, and folks, y'all go by and just give them a hug. Just tell them how much you appreciate them, and thank all of you, because as they said, would not have been possible without you. Took these kids to camp. You sent them to camp. And for you younger children here, this can be you in just a few years. Who has gone to every camp? Peyton, you've gone to every camp, hadn't you? And okay. Yeah, Faith Ann, she's not here. And I know some missed for who? Kaylee? Yep, Kaylee went. COVID kind of kept some of them from going last year, but they looked forward. They were not joking. They enjoy going to camp. And I want to thank the people that went, Mandy and Lacey and Bucky and Ed. But Bucky especially on the trips, because it's a rowdy bunch. Man, you know, they were a little shy up there on the stage. They not shy in the bus. They have poor old Bucky. But I love you guys.